Okay, all right, so welcome to my stream. This is my second Twitch stream. I actually had a stream last week, but for some reason Twitch doesn't automatically save VODs, so I don't have that VOD. Was just a thunder right now. It's been raining for like 5 days straight. Like there's some stops like in between for like a couple hours, but still it's insane. I haven't heard of thunder in a while though. All right, so anyways, I'm just gonna be reacting to a bunch of songs right now, and actually I wanted to try something. So a couple weeks ago I reacted to Hi Ren by Ren. It's a song that came like 10 months ago, and it got 76 views, which is a lot for me. It's my second most popular video. So, and I haven't watched the GTA 1, GTA 6 trailer yet, so I wanted to see how well this is gonna do on YouTube. So, here we go, GTA 6 trailer. I haven't actually played any GTA game,
Lucia,
but I
where the hell
really
are
want to
you?
play it.
Bad luck, I guess.
Graphics are real fucking good. An alligator inside a fucking gas station. Like, I know it's Florida. I'm pretty sure this is like their version of Miami. But why did they let an alligator inside of a damn gas station? Also, I love that they like ha kind of have their own version of TikTok or Instagram in the game. Like, I'm assuming that's what it is, at least.
Well, look who's back. The only way we're gonna get through this is by sticking together, being a team. Trust?
Trust.
Twenty-25, that's just in 2 years. That's actually actually that's 1 year. That's still a long time. But it's not as long as 10 years, so it's good. Alright. I don't have a lot to say about this, because I can't really compare it to any other game, because I haven't played any GTA game. But alright, so next up we got, and this is actually on my Bring Me the Horizon reaction. Oh wait, sorry. That's on my Bring Me the Horizon reaction. Like, two people suggested this song to me. It's Damaged by October Ends. It's a pretty new song. Like, it's cause considering two people suggested this, I'm assuming, which is a lot for me. It was like, it wasn't even in the span of a long time. That was like in the span of a couple hours between each other. So I'm assuming this is gonna be a pretty good song. But from what I read about this like melodic hardcore or something. So I guess it should be good. Man, it is raining a lot right now. Okay, I can't really see anything. Like, the net on my window is really wet from there. Alright, let's go. Oh yeah, right, they're a female-led band too. Sorry. It can't go wrong with an electronic intro. Well, I guess they're not female-led. Like, I saw that girl in the thumbnail, I assume she's the singer or something like that. Okay. Still building up. I expected a drop right there. Not the thunder. Okay, still not getting heavy. I'm feeling it's gonna, either at the midway point of the song, or like near the end of the song, it's gonna get insane. Vibe. Some China we got with the drums. This voice is really good. Come on, where's the drop? It's kind of hard to hear the guitar, honestly. Ooh, nice vocals. Come on, come on. Okay, I don't really like that. Definitely not what I expected. Okay, wait, let me do something. Where is it? Seek out. Okay, so thank you to What About 9 and by 28 for the suggestions. Didn't really like the song, honestly. Absolutely, definitely not what I expected. I thought it was going to be a lot heavier than that. But yeah, not really my style. Thanks for the suggestion, though. Alright, so now we got some more Plankton Core. Boy, what did the Plan Z and a Neon Tide, which are like heat, those are just regular, really good actually, modern metal songs, but he put an AI filter on his voice, an AI Plankton filter on his voice, so it sounds like Plankton. So this is a song with him, by Jarris Johnson, featuring Boy What. And judging by Orion's thumbnail, I'm assuming this is going to be a black. So I'm pretty excited. Battling my demons. Sorry, sorry about that. Got a really good voice there. Cool chorus. Really good chorus so far. Really hooky too. Real catchy. Ooh, nice. Ah, there was Boy What. Fuck it. Okay. And now it's not a drop there. His voice gets good, really good. Why do I have subtitles? Oh, we've got the breakdown. Come on. Oh! Fuck yeah! We got some blah. Yeah. What the fuck? What is it, a System of a Down now? La 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 la. What the fuck? What the fuck are these vocals now? Oh, that was his vocals. Man, I love this song. That was really good. I really liked it. Man, that blah. That breakdown in general was so good. It was really fucking good. I fucking loved it. I'm just adjusting my camera. I'm trying to find the best angle for it. think that's a good. I think that's a good angle. That was a really good song. I really liked it. All right, so now next we got this. Some girl in my class suggested me to listen to the song. So, and I've heard several Pantera songs. Obviously, I've heard "Walk" and "Domination" and shit, and "Cowboys from Hell." I haven't heard this one though. She said it was really good, so I was like, why not react to it? The Pantera Tens. Got some ambience. Why does it sound like fucking girl, Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam, but more gurgled? It's like fucking Eddie Vedder. I don't know why. Like, weirder. Very, pretty atmospheric, too. A lot slower than what I'm used to from this band. It's still pretty good. Got a soul? Maybe? Probably gonna get a soul from this man, from in this song. There it is, yeah. Oh, we've got a bunch of bands from. Bunch of bends from Dimebag here. Honestly, not a real fit. Melodic, more melodic solos, especially over that calm of music in the back of instrumentals in the background. Doesn't really fit Dimebag Darrell, to be honest. I really like this song. Okay, the songs are pretty good. Not really what I listen to usually. It's still pretty good. Let me check something real quick. Last time it didn't save my VOD. I want to just make sure. It's gonna save it now. Okay, I'm pretty sure it's gonna say that. Alright, so I've got a new Northlane song. I don't think I've ever heard a Northlane song. Northlane song. I'm pretty sure they're like 2000s metalcore. Although their name is very modern metalcore, to be honest. And it's featuring someone from Parkway Drive, which is another 2000s metalcore band. I don't know what instrument he plays, but he probably does play some instrument. Vocals, kind of vocals too. The fourth lane, that's Miasma, sorry. Pretty modern metalcore in shape, by the way. Electronic intro, alright. Sounds really weird. That like that there's like ambience with those vocals, like and the bass and drums, like everything sounds really weird here. Why do I have subtitles turned on? I've turned on, I have no idea. Help it sound better. No, it does not sound better at all. You say the N-word there? I swear to fuck, it sounded like I said the N-word. Oh, manipulated, I think. Pretty good so far. Thank you. Alright, well, I'm putting my beanie on. Now I think I shouldn't be worried about my hair. Ooh, with the lows. I think I just saw lightning outside. Yeah, okay, it's definitely saying manipulated. I just spit there a little bit. Okay, that was pretty good. Okay, for some reason, the sound on YouTube. Does it's like on this computer specifically, the sound when I like hear songs on YouTube sounds really weird. Like it's pretty different than what it sounds and when I hear it on Spotify on this computer. Honestly, even on TV or on my phone, it sounds a lot different. Which now that I'm thinking about it, kind of makes sense. So yeah, never mind. But yeah, it sounds really weird. But like even on Spotify on my computer, it sounds pretty different. Okay, that was pretty good. All right, now this is a singer my sister suggested me to listen to. Me and my dad heard one of her songs on the way back from mine and my sister's horse riding lesson. So we heard one of her songs, apparently her newest song, and it was pretty good. Like, and it was especially. The reason I chose to actually react to it is that it kind of sounded metal because I think I heard Double Kick. There's some Double Kick there, but I looked it up and turns out she's punk rock and also that she's a TikTok star. Which I was not expecting for some reason. But I'm expecting this to be pretty good. I told you so by Bayless Speed. Again, there's some double kick here. Sister, I think she said it sounds kind of like Linkin Park. She's kind of pretty dirty too. It's pretty annoying. Pretty good so far. That is real pissing me off. There's like here and here and here, especially. And there's like two pieces of like dirt that I can't remove. It's not even like it like doesn't even feel like it's actually on the screen. What the fuck? Oh, what? I'm fucking it. It's a part of this music video. Though there's one here anyway that you can't see. Pretty good. That's pretty good so far. That's some fast-paced drums. Oh, that was pretty good. So next I've just got pounded. It's so fucking pounded right now. So next up we got some new Alpha Wolf. I think I heard like one of their songs. And I have never heard of Iced Tea. I like Fuse Tea. I like drinking Fuse Tea. I've never heard of Iced Tea. That was a shit joke. I need to shut the fuck up and listen to this song. Why is it like this? There we go. Sucks to suck. Sucks to suck indeed. Can't go wrong with some electronics. I'd be a piece of shit. His face there, what the hell was that? What the fuck was that face? Dude, the drum tone is insane. It's insanely good. Some lo-fi guitar in the background, some rapping, kind of rapping. A crap growl, I would say. What the fucking zombie? What the fuck is this? What the fuck was that? What the fuck is that thing? Fucking zombie. With some cheerleader vocals. I mean, they do deserve it. In the music video, of course. Not in real life, obviously. I wouldn't know them in real life. Why does this zombie thing look like Pepe the Frog, kind of? Like with the lips and shit, it kind of looks like Pepe the Frog, but weird. Surely the vocals again. Ah, this is Ice-T probably. Hold on, trying to do. Why is that zombie thing dancing? Oh, I got an fuck. How is it this guy? Like, I had like a small thing right before it happened, then it was gonna be that guy. How the fuck is this guy? Is it that guy? Oh, hell yeah. What? Never mind, not hell yeah. That was a really good song. I loved it. Well, yeah, it was something as himself. Oh, Ice-T has himself. Okay, that was a really good song. Nope. Not watching this ad. Right now, I was planning on reacting to this song like when it came out, but I was too lazy to do that. I was too lazy to like edit the song, so I was like, you know what, I'll just react to it on my next stream. After my last stream, because the last stream was a full album reaction. So yeah. Alright. Well, I think I heard like two of the songs. God of Fire and Vendetta. Both are really heavy and really good. Alright, let's go. Some lo-fi intro. At a restaurant. Yeah, I don't know, like a fast food place. Or a fast food place in the future, I guess. And we got some cleans. Why does the bassist look like Andrew Tate? I don't know, looks like Andrew Tate. Really hooky. Nice. Oh, I got some lows too. Sorry about that. Not all the noise there. Did it say you're the pin of the hand grenade? I'm pretty sure it did. That's what we got a part C. Some bendy boys. Ooh, those lows. You got some alternative courses right there. That spray tan is awesome. Really good song. I liked it. I'm not sure if I liked it more than Vendetta or... No, actually, I think I kind of liked more than Vendetta. Not more than God of Fire. Was like their second best song now, in my opinion. Alright, so next, we actually got three Death Funk songs that I haven't heard yet. If you don't know who Death Funk is, it's just Nick Nocturnal making funk metal. Not funk, F-U-N-K, but funk. P-H-O-N-K. Like he says, funk is practically just metal, but with electronics instead of guitars. Yeah, also all these songs are less than 2 minutes. This one is called Hard. What's happening? That's awesome. Let me do something real quick. I would stew. That's some trauma bending, as I like to call it, even though I've never seen that in my life. Well, still. That's pretty good. Now the next song is Dope, which is from 2 months ago. That one was 4 months ago. And I have to reload again. Some pinch harmonic too. Pretty good. Yeah, got some build up. I think the rain stopped actually. Not going outside. I'm not going outside anyways. Well, that was pretty good too. I think One is definitely his best song with this project, to be honest. I didn't have to reload this one. Refresh this one. Maybe I just don't need to go full screen and then press play. I don't know. This is the latest one from like 2 weeks ago. Oh, there's actual vocals that aren't sampled. Oh yeah, right, that's with the Shell and G. Who's, I'm assuming, someone from a rap metal band. He was in Darko US's song Evolving Pressure, which is like their best song, and it's insanely heavy. Ooh, nice. Okay, so that was also pretty good. So I was planning on doing a couple more songs, but my stomach kind of hurts, so I decided now to just straight up go to like the main focus of the stream, which is Oversimplified's new video. Now I'm gonna watch the recap of his previous two videos, and then watch that one. Well, I guess I don't have to not zoom in before plus and not go full screen before pressing play.
Seemed inevitable. So if you put a very strategically important island between them, 2 + 2 = war.
Yeah, I guess so.
Sicily was an island. Islands are surrounded by water. Charge!
NordVPN there.
From scratch. They developed ingenious new ways of waging war. They attempted an invasion of the Carthaginian heartland. Look at this thing. It's unbelievable. And whenever disaster struck them, they always came back again. And again.
Or are they fucking Wooly Mafton?
The Romans have built another fleet. Oh, for goodness sake! The Carthaginian leaders, possibly the greatest military general of the time, a man named Hamilcar Barca, to the island.
Oh, no!
But in the end, it was Roman determination that won the fight.
I just don't care!
And you have to pay us 2,200 talents of silver over the next 20 years.
Ay, caramba! That will cripple us!
One day, Carthage will have
its revenge.
My beautiful son.
You are vengeance.
This feels like a trailer. That genuinely sounds like a movie trailer. Alright, so anyways, it took him like a year, I think. Yeah, his last video was a year ago, like before these three. And these two already got 5 from 4, 5. Hold on, what?
This video
Oh,
is
no.
Awesome.
This two already got more than 5 million views in 6 days.
By NordVPN, click merch store for some new character pins, the last remaining bucket plushies, and even a calendar. And I'm
What?
not done yet.
Calendar and YouTube's.
To bring you an exclusive YouTube's. Go and
All right.
Hey, what are you still doing here? I said go and buy it now.
Yeah, nah, I can't. Let me just do something. So, I'm gonna take off the beat. It's not comfortable with headphones. So, Seek of Carthage. 241 BCE, immediately after the First Punic War.
Our beloved mercenaries, let's hear it. Okay, thank you one and all for your hard work fighting in the First Punic War. Maybe try it a little harder, but this isn't the finger-pointing convention. I know you all have one thing on your minds. Hey, when are we all getting paid? Remember you lost your... Okay, Jim, why don't you tell them? I'm not telling them, you tell them. Ugh. Look, you're not getting paid.
Okay, he's dead.
War and owe the Romans a ton of reparations. Of course we can't pay you in full.
He's dead. Yeah, it's over.
This place to the ground? Come on, fellas. Will killing us really make you feel better about
Yes.
Yes. Way to go, sir. Shut up, Jim. You're fired. I guess that makes two of us. Huh? In the aftermath of the First Punic War, Carthage's disgruntled mercenaries left unpaid for all their hard work. Revolted, and Carthage found itself caught up in an extremely destructive mercenary war. The panicked Carthaginians hired more mercenaries to fight the mercenaries they couldn't afford to pay, and Carthage came dangerously close to collapse. All the while, across the water, there was Rome. Ha! Look at those morons! We just kicked their ass in the First Punic War, and now their own mercenaries are revolting. Ha! Yeah. Wait, First Punic War? You mean there's going to be a second? Taking advantage of this situation? So almost certainly, yes. The Romans did, in fact, take advantage of the situation. Amongst the chaos, rebels on the Carthaginian island of Sardinia sent out a cry for help to Rome. Hot diggity dog, said the Romans. That's free real estate. And so in they went. Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's our island. Get the hell off. Hey, they requested our help. We're simply... Help. Oh, no, you don't. Look, we're sending our own army to deal with the rebels, okay? But just to be clear, we're not trying to start a fight with you, so, you know, don't declare war on us or anything.
War. We surrender!
Great. And as part of the peace treaty, we get to keep these islands.
No!
The Carthaginians were hopping mad. But their humiliating loss in the First Punic War wasn't bad enough. The Romans now took advantage of their mercenary problem and stole their islands. This shocking land grab was pretty hard to justify, even by Roman standards. Additionally, the Romans now demanded Carthage pay them even more money on top of what was already owed. If Rome was trying to make Carthage as mad as possible, they were doing a fantastic
Well, I guess so.
The seeds of a second Punic War were being sown, and they were being watered with Carthaginian tears. Resentment in Carthage only continued to grow. Eventually, Carthage solved their mercenary problem thanks to Carthaginian military genius and hero of the First Punic War, Hamilcar Barca. He sorted those naughty mercenaries out with some good old-fashioned atrocities, and the destructive mercenary war was over. Still, all was not well in Carthage. Mere decades ago, they were the top dogs in the Western Mediterranean. Now, after the crushing defeat in the First Punic War and a huge bill for the Romans, Carthage was well and truly under Rome's thumb. What on earth were they supposed to do? If they wanted any chance at regaining their former strength, there was one thing they needed now, more than anything. Money. But as long as they owed Rome a bazillion dollars, there was nothing they could do. Fortunately for them, amongst their ranks, there was one heck of a man with one big lump of brain. Me!
Hamilcar Barca!
Yes! Wait, why do you all have the exact same voice?
I have it too!
That's
Dude, I love when his videos, like, the characters in the videos are so self-aware sometimes. So stupid.
Greatest general alive, and the poster above my bed, Hamilcar Barca, had an idea. Alright, we
face reveal.
One word for you. Spain. An area filled with lucrative silver mines, from which the silver would flow like a river, and our pockets would be stuffed.
like Tony's mother at a buffet. Hey,
what?
Here's my proposal. You send me to the army to Spain. I'll expand our territory, get those silver mines up and running, and we'll be able to pay the Romans back in no time. Okay. Just to check, you're not secretly raising the money to go on a bloodthirsty revenge spree against Rome, are you? Because we can't afford that. Hanno, my dear, I'm simply going to pay them back.
Not literally, actually.
That wasn't reassuring. In the First Punic War, as Hamilcar Barca, 98% of his brain matter had been reallocated to thoughts of revenge. He was also fed up with the Carthaginian politicians for what he cowardly betrayal when they surrendered at the end of the last war. And so for Hamilcar, going to Spain meant being able to act independently from the weak Carthaginian government, building his own strength, and then perhaps somewhere down the line, revenge. However, he wasn't going to perhaps somewhere down the line. However, he wasn't going to Spain by himself. Hannibal? Yes, father? Would you like to come with me to build an empire in Spain?
Oh boy,
would I? Barbara, mind if I take our 9-year-old son with me? I want to implant an intense hatred of Rome in him and prepare him for a campaign of vengeance. Just try not to traumatize him, dear. No promises. A young boy would accompany his father. Watch him, learn it. Boy, you see that city over there? Yes, father? That is Rome. Do you know what we do to Romans? No, father. We hate them, Hannibal. We hate them with every fiber of our being. Father, can't I just play with my Digimons? No, son! They took everything from us. Our land, our wealth.
This is so cinematic.
Those animals. I'll tear them loose from limb. I'll burn their pathetic city to the ground. Dad? I'm so proud. I'll slaughter their people. I'll cut off their faces and wear them as masks. After taking him and having him swear an oath never to be a friend of Rome, off dad and son went for a lovely beach holiday in Spain. But Spain was already inhabited by many tribespeople, and when Hamilcar suddenly showed up in their territory, they were like, "Hey, who the hell are you? What are you doing here? I'm teaching my son how to become a warrior like me." Aw, well that's sweet. Well then, little guy, let's see what you got. Good boy.
Oh.
Guys, this is an urgent crisis.
I don't want ads right now.
Inhabited by many tribes people. And when Hamilcar
okay, I live in Israel, and I still want this war to end already. Just want a hostage deal and our army out of there. Please end that war already.
Suddenly showed up in their territory. They were like, "Hey, who the hell are you? What are you doing here? I'm teaching my son how to become a warrior like me." Uh-huh. Well, that's sweet. Well then, little guy, let's see what you got. Good boy. As Hamilcar got to work fighting the tribes of Iberia and expanding Carthaginian influence, Hannibal became a child of war, even earning battle scars from a young age. And he grew to become a great military leader himself, making his father very proud. I love you so much, son. Dad, not in front of the enemy. You killed that guy so well, son. The Barkas successfully consolidated Carthaginian power, got those silver mines up and running, and were sending buckets of cash back to a money-starved Carthage. And symbolizing Carthage's regrowing strength, a beautiful new city would eventually be founded in Spain. New Carthage, with a magnificent palace.
We got some war thunders.
Back, baby. What in the name of Apollo is going on here? Romans! Flowing silver mines? Dancing elephants? What are you up to, Hamilcar? I'm simply gathering the money to pay you back. Oh. Well, okay then. Or are you rebuilding strength to go on a bloodthirsty revenge spree? Like I said, Claudius, I'm simply trying to pay.
This is so stupid.
You guys are hugging. No. I was hugging.
The This is amazing.
From the Median Carthaginian politicians, his power was becoming immense. But Dad, yes, my son? I'm confused. Are we really simply paying the Romans back? We're not gonna go on a bloodthirsty revenge spree? Of course we are. I'm just saying that to get the Romans off our backs. Listen, here's the most important life lesson I have for you. Vengeance is everything. An all-encompassing thirst for vengeance is great for your mental health. Are you still confused? No, no, I get it now. But what if the Romans find out what we're up to? They won't find out. Why? Well, Hannibal, because I use NordVPN.
Oh my god.
I'm confused again.
I'm gonna skip this. Okay, actually, you know what? I'm not gonna skip this because it's probably fine. I'll watch it later. I'm gonna skip this. I'm not sponsored.
My channel. So thank you. Now, where were we? Oh yeah. Carthaginian tears, a child of war, and the Carthaginian conquest of Spain. The Carthaginian recovery had been staggeringly quick, and Rome was seriously alarmed. But they were also preoccupied with ongoing wars elsewhere, including an expansionist war to the north, where they were enslaving thousands of northern Celts. So for now, to keep Carthage in check, the Romans insisted on a new treaty. See this river. The two sides agreed that everything above it was in Rome's sphere of influence, while beneath it was Carthage. Under no circumstances were the Carthaginians to expand north of that river. But for now, Hamilcar and son were living it up. Well, son, here's to many more years of successful campaigning in Spain. Now, if you'll excuse me, I just have to go fight those guys. See you later, son. I love you. What the? Oh, crap. I drowned? Oh, well. Always remember, son. You are vengeance.
Is that like from a movie where someone says you are vengeance or I am vengeance? I think there's a movie like that.
Also, delete my browsing history. Tragically ambushed at a river and drowned. His son-in-law, and possibly also his lover, no further questions, took charge for a while. He too was later assassinated, leaving finally a 26-year-old Hannibal in charge of the Carthaginian armies in Spain. Sources say the men readily accepted him as their leader. He chose to suffer the same hardships as his men. He lived in the same conditions, was often the first into battle and the last one out. And it also helped that he looked a lot like his dad. He had the total respect of his men. If he said jump, they said how high. If he said tuck me in, they said how tight. If he said talk to a girl without peeing your pants, they said that's impossible. Nobody can. An army that would follow him anywhere would be crucial for exacting his vengeance against Rome. Hannibal's army had become a strong and loyal fighting force, and that was making a certain nation very uncomfortable. Seeing Carthage re-strengthen so quickly was not something Rome had expected. Yet here they were, paying off their debts and expanding their territory. It didn't feel very much like Carthage was under Rome's thumb at all, and Rome wanted to put an end to it. Tensions were strung tighter than your liar's G-string, and all it take was one incident to trigger tighter than your liar's G-string. And all it
as a guitarist, I love this joke.
Take was one incident to all out war.
I need to find the shut up with the ads.
Paying off their debts and expanding their territory. War. And in 219 BC, a city in Spain would find itself at the very center of that fateful incident, Saguntum. Remember
Saguntum?
Declaring everything south of this river to be Carthage's sphere of influence? Well, Saguntum should therefore obviously be Carthaginian, right?
Wrong!
Saguntum had actually scored itself an informal alliance with Rome, after Rome had helped it with an internal dispute. With Carthaginian encroachment, Saguntum began to fear for its independence, and Rome declared itself Saguntum's protector. But this clearly went against the Ebro River Treaty. So what on earth was Rome doing? Were the Sugantines and the Romans truly just BFFs? It's possible. Or was Rome deliberately trying to interfere with Hannibal's Spanish expansion and maintain a staging post for a future war with Carthage? More likely, Hannibal certainly viewed this Rome-Saguntum alliance as an outrage, yet another example of Roman arrogance. At first, he left Saguntum alone, but having learnt from his father to hate all things Roman and having inherited his father's dream of bringing Rome to its knees more and more, Hannibal may have begun to see Saguntum as an opportunity. Could this controversial alliance be just what devilish little Hannibal needed to kickstart a second war with Rome and restore Carthaginian dominance? It's even possible that Rome were also using Saguntum.
I don't think you could hear that thunder.
And kick him out of Spain. And to goad Hannibal's right, so they could go and kick him out of Spain. And as the two giants began gearing up for round two, the poor people of Saguntum had no idea that they were about to be crushed in the collision. Your alliance with Saguntum is an insult, and we won't stand for it. They're our friends, Hannibal, and if you lay a finger on them, it'll be an act of war. Yeah, Hannibal, back the hell off. War? I was thinking I might just besiege their city and massacre their people. I hope you do, Hannibal. Find out what happens. Yeah, we hope you do, Hannibal. Wait, what? Maybe I'll go ahead. Kill them all. Okay, then. Fine. Okay, guess I'll do just that. Consul, we look forward to it. Consul? You're gonna protect us, though, right, Consul? Consul!
Yeah, they're dead. I've never heard so many down nows at the same time. Also, I always thought that sound like Palpatine saying that. Oh, that's actually a very similar flag to Spain's flag.
Carthaginian territory, enough was enough. In an action that was guaranteed to provoke the Romans into war, Hannibal besieged the city. The siege of Saguntum lasted 8 cruel months before Hannibal broke through the city defenses and turned Saguntum into a killing field. It was a massacre.
What the hell?
Tell me I didn't just catch you massacring our friends, the Sugantees. Well, Consul, if you like the Sugantees so much, perhaps you should suck on these nuts. Hearing word of the attack on Saguntum, Rome was understandably in an uproar, and all eyes were now fixated on what would happen next, as Rome sent a delegation to Carthage, led by one of the most highly esteemed Roman senators, Fabius Maximus. He demanded an answer for Hannibal's sins. All right, listen up, scum. You've got a rogue general in Spain attacking a Roman ally. What are we supposed to do about it? Well, there shouldn't have even been a Roman ally in Spain. You're the aggressor here. Hand Hannibal over to us as a criminal so we can punish him severely. No, yes, no, no. Look, I hold in the folds of my toga both peace and war. Which one should I let drop? Whichever one you want. Then I choose.
What the fuck?
Then I.
What the fuck? This is one of the funniest videos on his channel. Funniest parts on his channel. Funniest videos, actually. One of the funniest moments in it. Had begun. I thought the video was gonna end here, in like part 2. It was gonna start. Like, right after that.
Boys,
well, those 10 more minutes.
We already destroyed these clowns, and we were the underdogs. Now, we're the overdogs? Hot dogs. Exactly. We're the overdogs? Hot dogs. Exactly. This is gonna be EZ. Here's the plan. Consul Longus, you take your army and sail straight for Carthage. Burn that city to the ground. And Consul Scipio, you just head on over to Iberia and make sure this cannibal guy doesn't do anything crazy. I mean, what's he gonna do? Cross the Alps?
Yes, probably.
We're going to what? Cross the Alps. We're going to what? I just told you, Hannibal will freeze to death. Trust me, Jerome. The Romans are expecting us to fight the same way we did last time. Passively, taking no initiative. They think it's gonna be E-Z. So this time, we have to be aggressive. We have to go on the attack. It sickens me to say this, but this time, we have to be a little more Roman.
You mean we're gonna take poops and baths together?
But I'm insecure about my hairy legs.
No! This time, we're gonna take the fight to them. Think about it. Rome thinks they're simply going to invade us and win the war. So when they suddenly find themselves being invaded from the north, they'll freak out. Like Tony's mother, when the buffet runs out. I gotta admit, it's actually kind of genius.
And my hairy legs will insulate me from the cold.
The spirit, Hannibal, you have my sword, and my spear, and my legs.
Poor guy. Poor guy, man.
Surprise the Romans was a bold but risky strategy. If it paid off, he could catch the Romans with their pants down, but he could also end up losing a ton of men and supplies in the hostile mountain conditions. Nevertheless, in 218 BC, with a fire in his eyes and some vengeance in his belly, Hannibal brought his force of almost 100,000 men across the Ebro River. They spent months on the road, trekking through the cold, hostile mountain conditions. And when they finally reached the other side, they said, "Hooray! We did it! We crossed the Alps." No, those were the Pyrenees. Those are the Alps. After crossing the Pyrenees, the army then had to pass through southern Gaul, a vast territory filled with tribespeople, many of whom were hostile to Hannibal's presence. His journey to the Alps was an ordeal in itself, as he was forced to fight his way through and incurred pretty hefty losses before even reaching the mountains. His plan was almost stopped in its tracks entirely, as the Roman consul Scipio, on his way to Iberia, discovered Hannibal was right on his doorstep. Suddenly, Hannibal's journey became a race, as he rushed to get his across the vast Rhone River before the Romans could intercept him. The crossing was chaotic, with the panicking elephants causing several men to drown. And the first combat of the war occurred when small scouting parties from each side encountered one another. When Scipio finally caught up to Hannibal's position, what he found was an empty Carthaginian camp. Hannibal had slipped through his fingers. The Roman consul Scipio felt the weight of the situation. Quite unbelievable.
I guess you could say he Scipioed through his fingers. Okay, I'll just shut up and watch the video.
Into Italy, and the Romans had no idea where he would emerge. For the first time, a Carthaginian force had the Roman homeland under threat. Scipio sent his men onto Iberia as planned, but he himself rushed home to raise a new army so that if Hannibal survived the crossing, Scipio would be there, waiting. Would you look at that, boys? We're here! The Alps! Although it is a little later than I expected. Yeah, it's kinda chilly. We'll set up camp here and wait for spring, right? It's way too cold, right? Hannibal's famous crossing of the Alps was brutal. It was already autumn, and the men suffered terribly. It was cold. Men would fall off the sides of icy cliffs. They starved. They fell off the sides of icy cliffs. Some sources say they had to eat their pack animals and would finish off dying comrades in order to take their clothes for extra warmth. And then they would fall off the sides of icy cliffs. Imagine an army of 50,000 men with all of their horses, supplies, and 37 elephants trying to navigate the most hostile mountain range in Europe. And it wasn't just nature that they were up against. Tribespeople lived in the mountains, and they couldn't believe what they were seeing. A tribe approached Hannibal and said, "Hey man, geez, that's some nice armor. What is that, gold? Man, I'd really like that armor. Hey boss,
They've got food as well. Shut up. Be cool.
Hey, why don't you let us guide you through this narrow gorge? We're not gonna kill you or nothing. Just walk right on through there. We're not gonna kill you. It's just right this way. We're not gonna kill you. Hannibal's army were forced to fight their way through the gorge as massive boulders rained down on them from above. Some clever reorganization of his line helped them survive, and they were able to fend off the opportunistic tribes. But losses from the constant attacks were heavy. As the journey continued, men who went over the sides would get stuck on the ice sheets below and had to make a grisly choice between starving to death or just getting it over with. When the deeply demoralized army reached the summit and rested for a couple days, Hannibal tried to lift their spirits with a rousing speech.
Look, men, down there, it's Rome. These plains stretching out in front of you are bountiful with food to eat and Romans to kill. Move, Bessie! Look, you have just climbed the walls of Rome. The hard part is over. From here on out, it's all downhill, and nobody else will die. Except for them. The rest of us here, no one dies.
Probably not.
Starting now.
Okay, let's go.
Oh, for goodness sake!
As it turned out, the descent was as deadly as the way up. With the cold really starting to set in, the path became even more narrow. And at one point, the men spent 3 days in the freezing cold repairing a collapsed road. When they finally reached the bottom, Hannibal said, "Look, guys, we did it." Well, I thought it went really well. When Hannibal left Spain, he had about 100,000 men. By the time he reached the Italian plains, his numbers had dwindled to about 26,000. He was now caught in enemy territory without a supply line or source of reinforcements. And any elephants who had survived to this point were almost certainly traumatized. So what on earth was Hannibal up to? This supposed military genius had just led a starving and weakened army right into enemy territory. Any modern general who lost half their men to mountains would be immediately fired and possibly even depantsed on live TV. Here's the thing. While Hannibal may not have planned on losing quite so many men, he had almost certainly expected considerable losses, and he always had a plan.
Sorry.
Need men? Northern Italy was full of men. Big, burly Celtic men. All the men Hannibal would ever need to beat off Rome. These Celts were filled with resentment, having only recently been conquered by Rome. Hannibal hoped to be seen as a liberator, convince the Celts to cut ties with Rome, and instead join him in crushing Rome. That way, he could gain a source of reinforcements and supplies right in Rome's backyard. But sir, in order to win the loyalty of the Celts, we would need to make a seriously favorable impression on them. How do we get them to like us? Kill them. One of Hannibal's first actions in Italy was to obliterate a nearby tribe who wouldn't join him. This sent a clear message to all the other tribes. It was his wrath they should fear, not Rome's. The realization that a Carthaginian army had just invaded them must have been shocking for the Romans. But when they looked at this ragtag group broken by the Alps, they couldn't have felt very intimidated. However, Hannibal was now in Italy, and he was about to embark on one of the most astonishing military campaigns in all of human history. The Romans may not have known it yet, but there was now a monster loose in their territory, and he was vying for Roman blood.
Okay, then that's the end of part one. So now we got part two.
This video was made possible by 60% YouTube's before too late. Don't make me mention it a third time, or I'll you know what.
What the fuck?
Crossing of the Alps, and he was now in Italy. With Hannibal's arrival, the Roman consul Scipio hit the ground running. In typical Roman fashion, he marched his army straight at the enemy, and Hannibal began preparing for his first combat with Rome on Italian soil. Before the battle, Hannibal wanted to inspire his men, so he staged a gladiatorial death match between captured Celt prisoners, with the winner getting prizes and freedom. He then explained that the whole thing was a metaphor. A metaphor? For what? You! These warriors are you! You're trapped in Italy with no escape. Your only choice now is to fight and win. What about the dead guy? That's you if you don't win. And the prizes? That's what you stand to gain by winning. And the fact that I've soiled myself in all this excitement? That... No, that's not part of the metaphor. Okay. Hannibal is head of a goat. For instance, Skipper, on the other hand, opted for the more classic route of a rousing pre-battle speech. Look at them men. Weak, starved by the Alps, while we are the strongest military in the world. This will be easy. Like 10,000 horse-sized ducks fighting a baby-sized baby. It'll be like Mike Tyson in his prime, kicking a baby. A tug of war between 10 sumo wrestlers and a... Help me out here, Ralph. A baby, sir? Yes! Yes, that's it! A baby! The point is, there is absolutely no possible way we could lose a battle this easy. So, if everybody's ready, on my mark...
I love that face.
The battle of Ticinus was over almost as soon as it had begun, as the Romans found themselves completely outmatched by Hannibal's famed, lightning-fast Numidian cavalry, a key element in Hannibal's devastating double envelopment tactics. In the chaos, Scipio was wounded. Thankfully, according to some ancient writers, his handsome 17-year-old son, Scipio the Younger,
was an enemy.
And in the process, earned himself a lot of daddy's kisses. The Romans ended up fleeing the area, destroying the bridge behind them as they went. For a nation so overtly confident in victory, believing Hannibal to be an easy kill, the Romans found themselves running away with their tail between their legs. It was humiliating. And you know who thought so as well? The Celts. They began flocking to Hannibal's side, just as he'd hoped. Even Celtic troops fighting for Rome in the Roman camp began to reconsider. Man, I'm thinking we should try to join Hannibal. I hear you. Maybe we should bring him a gift. What do you think he'd like? Oh, I know. Hey, Hannibal. We want to join your side, and we brought you a present.
A Roman's head?
For me? I hope it's Roman heads. Oh, please, be Roman heads.
That told you.
How did you know? Running away from the Romans was humiliating enough, but having dozens of Romans beheaded in the night. Now that's embarrassing. Ticinus had been a relatively small battle, but the psychological impact it had early on was huge, and it was only just a taste of what Hannibal was capable of. Despite the shocking initial loss, however, Rome still didn't seem to understand the danger posed by the monster now loose in their territory. The Senate was full of excuses. It's those traitorous Celts. That's why we lost. Yeah, and it was a cavalry battle. Wait until Hannibal faces our almighty legions. And our consul was bald. Once he faces our other fully follicled consul, then he'll really pee his pants. That other consul, Longus, had been in the south all this time, preparing to invade Africa. He had seen some success, even capturing Malta. But then he heard the news. Hannibal's in Italy? And I'm being ordered home? But I was gonna be the big boy! I was gonna invade Carthage and win the war! Well, you can be a big boy at home. No! Does somebody need a nap, sir? No! 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 And so Longus brought his army on the long journey north. When he arrived in the area to decisively neutralize Hannibal, the two consuls joined their forces together, creating a double consular army. But the two consuls weren't exactly on the same page. Having a nice rest there, old man? I'm wounded, Longus. Pathetic. You don't understand. He's more dangerous than we thought. Maybe for you. Whoops. Listen, we can't just march straight at him like we normally do. We need to train our men through the winter, and we'll try again in spring. Sorry, I don't take advice from a bowling ball. Hey, I'll kick your ass, Longus. Any day now. I'm coming. Just you wait. Scipio, you feeble old man.
What the hell was that scream?
Couldn't wait to give Hannibal a swirly. So who? Longus. Scipio was apparently quite cautious after his recent encounter with Hannibal, while Longus, typically Roman, couldn't wait to give Hannibal a swirly. So who would get their way? Well, when two consuls joined forces, it turned out the Romans had an interesting system in place. They would each take turns being the one in charge. Consul 1 would lead one day, then Consul 2 the next. Back and forth, back and forth. As you can imagine, when the two consuls didn't agree, things didn't go so well. In this case, due to Scipio's injury, Longus
probably got a view
more command than normal. Hannibal had Celtic spies in the Roman camp. He fully understood the Roman system and Longus's hot-headed nature, and he knew he could exploit it.
For goodness sake!
What's wrong, sir? I'm trying to order some pizza, but I keep getting fed all these personalized ads about being a hothead.
I'm not a hothead, am I?
No, sir. Look at this. Butt insurance? Who would buy butt insurance? Sounds really good. It seems like a lot of data brokers have collected data on you. They could sell that data to Hannibal.
What?
But don't worry, because you can get rid of that data with
Incognito.
Incogni.
Yeah.
I've been getting at you for.
Yeah. Wait, what?
Don't worry, because you
incogni. Hooray!
I've been getting at you for some time to protect your personal data online, but you're in limits, aren't you? You didn't do it, did you? Typical. And now would you look at that? Tons of data brokers have collected a heck of a lot of your personal data and might sell.
Oh, I gotta skip this one.
Oh yeah. Roman heads, a double consul army, and a hothead. Hannibal needed to keep smashing the Romans in battle in order to maintain the loyalty of the Celts, and so he was eager to fight another battle. The combined Roman force possibly outnumbered him, so he carefully crafted a clever trap, and he made sure to spring it while Longus was still in charge. The plan began with his army getting an early night's sleep. All right, boys. Time for lights out. Sorry, but we got a big day ahead of us. Tomorrow, we're gonna massacre the Romans. Dream of revenge. Gorzog, send out.
What the hell?
Cavalry made their way over to the Roman camp, arriving just before dawn. Hey, Romans. Wakey, wakey.
What the? What's going on?
Hey, Longus, your butt smells like a butt.
It does not! Scipio, awaken the troops.
Longus, these playground insults are clearly meant to lure you out.
Well, it's working. Send out the troops.
Longus, it's clearly a trap.
And I'm falling for it. Send out the troops!
Hey, guys, wake up. You're heading out for battle.
What? But we haven't had breakfast. We're skipping breakfast! I don't think you can do that.
As the Romans hurried out of camp, the Numidians began luring them back to the Carthaginian camp, where these gentle angels were just awakening from their slumber.
Eat up, boys. We're having pancakes.
While the Carthaginians were enjoying their hearty breakfast, the starving Romans were still on their way.
Hurry up. We have to catch those Numidians. Hey, why have you stopped marching?
Longus, there's a freezing river in front of us.
Well, get your gluteus maximus in the water!
All right, boys. Time to lather up. This oil will insulate you from the cold. It also smells like lavender. There's the Carthaginian camp. Get ready to fight, men.
Sir? I think the water from the river is beginning to ice over. I can't move.
Oh, I'm sorry. You thought war would be fun? Sitting around a nice hot campfire playing Truth or Dare with your friends?
Welcome to the real world!
Who do you like?
Sharon.
Look, guys. The Romans are here. Having perfectly orchestrated events so that his enemy was cold, tired, and hungry, while his men were well-rested and covered in oil. When the two sides engaged one another, the Romans were in no condition to fight. And the cherry on top? The previous night, Hannibal had sent out an elite force of men led by his brother to go and hide behind a bush.
They suddenly sprung out, encircling the exhausted Romans, who were then cut to pieces. Once again, Hannibal's superior cavalry and double envelopment tactics had flummoxed the Romans. But the key word at Trebia was control. Hannibal used his intel on the enemy and the environment of the battlefield to carefully control the conditions of battle, creating lots of little advantages for himself that paved the way to success. And concealing troops for an ambush? All of these things are what make Hannibal the genius he's remembered as today. As for Longus, he managed to escape the battlefield with a small number of troops. Disgraced, he didn't want the Senate to find out what had happened, and he began obscuring communications back to Rome. Longus, where have you been? We've been looking for you. Nowhere in particular. Longus, 30,000 men are missing. Do you know where they are? They're taking a bath.
Taking a bath. Also, 30,000 men, that is a lot of people.
Aurora
Borealis?
Oh, well, that's my consulship over. Good luck with Hannibal. Bye! Had been a disaster for the Romans. And as even more Celts began flocking to Hannibal, Rome largely lost its control over Cisalpine Gaul. In Rome, complacency turned to alarm. Hannibal had outwitted them on their own soil and inflicted a costly defeat. But with that, Scipio and Longus's terms as consul were over. They were replaced with two new consuls, Servilius and Aemilius. The Romans may now have begun to realize the trouble they were in.
This guy looks like an anime character or something. Or like,
And the genius Hannibal had shown in invading Italy. The Romans had expected to be the ones controlling this war. Remember, they thought they were going to invade Carthage. Now their plans lay in ruins, and they were levying 11 new legions to deal with the threat. Hannibal had completely redefined the war. But Hannibal had a little problem of his own. Things had gone well so far, but the Celts were notoriously fickle, and Hannibal needed to ensure he maintained their alliance and his base of support in Italy. Any Celts he captured fighting for Rome, he treated extremely well and allowed them to return to their homes. But the longer he hung around in their territory, eating all their food and leaving beard trimmings in their sinks, the more resentful they may become. They wanted to go south and plunder some Roman booty, and Hannibal also hoped to sway Rome's other Italian allies in the south to his side. So from here, the path was clear. Hannibal had to move south. Just one problem. There were two main routes Hannibal could take to move south. And wouldn't you know it, that's exactly where the two new Roman consuls had taken fortified positions. If Hannibal tried to move on them, he'd be fighting from a disadvantaged position and could be bottled in. There is a third option. Ooh, tell me. We could move through this vast, impassable marshland flooded with dirty, stinky, disease-infested water that at times would come up to our necks. But there's no way we would attempt that, right?
They're gonna attempt that, aren't they?
Right? Hannibal? Hannibal's whole trek across the Arno marshlands was hell on earth. Almost as crazy as when he crossed the Alps. Imagine 3 full days unable to sit or lie down because there's nowhere to sit or lie down, meaning 4 full days without sleep, slugging through heavy mud. You contract cholera, your foot falls off, and Jim Bob directly in front of you won't stop pooping in your path. In fact, everybody's pooping in your path. Some delirious, sleepless men would see clumps of mud and say, "Man, I could just sink into that." And then they would. When pack animals died, it gave nearby men a chance to rest, but only for a few moments before they were whipped back into line. Even Hannibal himself couldn't escape the torture of it. "Hey Hannibal, if we see a Starbucks, can we stop? I need to take a leak." "What? Jeez, Hannibal, looks like you picked up a nasty eye infection. Normally for this sort of thing, we'd just wash it out with some clean water. But, as you can see, water everywhere, but it's full of Jim Bob's poop. No worries, Doc. I'll just take care of it myself." "That'll be $3,000.
Okay. Well, that's a good joke.
Just managed to slip 50,000 men right past the Romans into rich Etrurian lands
where he could replenish his supplies, and his Celt allies could go crazy, securing Roman loot and booty.
Oh, it's that guy. Went up in flames. One of the first Punic War videos.
The hot-headed Flaminius, feeling it was his responsibility to protect these lands, rather than waiting for his co-consul to come join him, immediately left to go chase Hannibal. Now, this Flaminius was an interesting character. He was what the Romans called a new man. He came from the lower plebeian classes of Roman society, and as a result, he reportedly had kind of a attitude to the establishment, and a big old arrogant chip on his shoulder. Picture Sylvius wearing a toga. That's Flaminius. And Hannibal, thanks to his spies, knew everything. Just as with Longus, Hannibal knew Flaminius was just the kind of man he could lure into a trap. Hannibal led Flaminius to the entrance of a narrow pass along the north shore of Lake Trasimene. Flaminius watched as Hannibal's army entered the pass. I've done it. I've spotted the enemy. Sir? That big follow us sign seems kind of like they're trying to lure you in. Yes, Gareth. And I'm taking the bait. Sir,
this met again.
Yes, Gareth. And I'm falling for it. Daylight was fading. So for now, the Romans set up camp. The two armies encamped across the lake from one another. And night fell over the two camps. In the morning, Flaminius would be the hero.
What is this poster? Like, I'm pretty sure it's a different version of the poster in real life, like a propaganda for a poster. I'm not sure which one. Also, this looks like a Minecraft bed.
Of Rome. For now, the Romans got nice and comfy in their beds. Good night, Flaminius. Good night, Rome. Good evening, Hannibal.
One yet.
During the night, Hannibal ordered total stealth. As tens of thousands of troops scaled the wooded hills above the pass, completely undetected by Rome's scouts. Let's go, girls. Flaminius took off across the lake shore to try to catch Hannibal. As he did, even the weather seemed to be on Hannibal's side. A thick fog rose from the surface of the lake, obscuring visibility. Look at this! This is perfect! The mist will obscure our approach. Hannibal will never see me coming.
That's unreal, man.
Does it sound like 50,000 Carthaginians are charging down the hill towards us? You mean 50,000 Carthaginians are charging right into my trap? The Romans found themselves completely hemmed in on all sides. With zero visibility in the fog, the fighting was terrifying and chaotic. Troops were pushed into the lake in their heavy armor, where they were either cut down or drowned. And Flaminius, who likely stood out like a sore thumb in his consul attire, caught the attention of one Celt warrior, with his head possibly swirling with thoughts of how the Romans had decimated his homeland. According to the ancient,
this is so cinematic.
Took his chance.
Please tell me he killed him. Holy shit, that was awesome. That was fucking awesome.
15,000 Romans were killed, and an equal number captured. An entire army completely wiped out, along with their consul. During the battle, the Roman vanguard had managed to break through at the front and climbed the hill above the fog. When the mist cleared, what they saw was a blood-red lake and a sea of Roman bodies.
What the fuck?
When the
other holy shit.
Cavalry to try to aid Flaminius's doomed legions, they too were caught and defeated. A double disaster. Rome went into a frenzy. For the second time, Hannibal had completely decimated an entire Roman army. Romans were dying by the tens of thousands. Common citizens began flocking to the city for safety. Women waited by the city gates in tears, hoping to hear news of loved ones. This one man, having just led his battered army across the Alps the previous year, now stood less than 100 miles from Rome. To this point, he had been a problem. Now, Hannibal was a crisis. And in a crisis, Rome took desperate measures. He actually had a system in place when dealing with an emergency of this magnitude. They would forego their two-console power-sharing system and instead temporarily give one man near-total power and authority to be as decisive as he needed and hopefully salvage the situation. This all-powerful position in Rome's government had a name, dictator. It's actually where we get the word. But unlike modern dictators, Roman ones didn't score perfect rounds of golf or ride bears to the Siberian tundra. They held their power for about 6 months before they were required to give it up. And in Rome's hour of need, the man chosen to be dictator in 217 BC, one of the most highly esteemed members of the Roman
Senate, Julius Caesar? No. Maximus. So how is I know where Julius Caesar becomes Caesar, honestly.
As dictator, confront Hannibal. Well, Fabius understood that marching all of Rome's young men straight into a one-man meat grinder was bleeding Rome dry. Hannibal was clearly too dangerous to face head-on in battle. However, he was also stuck in their territory. With dwindling manpower and forced to live off the land, it wasn't a sustainable position to be in long-term, and he could only remain there for so long. So, if Rome avoided battle with Hannibal to prevent any more crippling losses, and instead simply maneuvered around him, blocking supplies and taking out smaller contingents where possible, Hannibal would gradually become weaker, while Rome would gradually become stronger.
That is actually really smart. I'm feeling it's not gonna work though.
Okay, guys, I have an idea. See if you can follow me here, okay? Instead of
fighting, when he approaches, we run away. I love this bit. Oh, come on. I thought they were going to call him a genius.
Fabius's strategy couldn't have been any less Roman. Romans were meant to march headfirst into battle, not run away from it. It seemed cowardly, and Fabius was extremely unpopular. At this point, Hannibal was continuing south. He had to stay on the move to keep his army fed, and he was still aiming to undermine Rome's alliances in the south. As he went, in a calculated display of aggression, he devastated the Roman countryside and killed many Romans, all in plain sight of Fabius and his army. We're just gonna stand here? Yes. Are you a coward? No. But Fabius, that's my farm. Well, McDonald, thank you for your sacrifice. You're a hero now. Think of the stories you'll tell. Old McDonald. Shut up. But you know who else? Fabius's strategy? Hannibal. He understood the danger he was in. Turning Rome.
Is that a villager sound? A Minecraft villager sound?
The danger he
freaking pitched down Minecraft villager sound. Was not expecting that.
Required Hannibal to keep smashing the Romans in battle. He couldn't do that if Fabius wouldn't fight him. Multiple times, Hannibal tried to goad Fabius into a fight, but Fabius wouldn't bite. Failing that, he tried to turn Rome against Fabius. According to the writer Livy, he burned down all the farms he could, but any farm he learned was owned by Fabius himself. He left well alone. Hey, Fabius, why isn't he burning down your farm? You got some sort of a secret deal with him?
What? Of course not.
Hey, Hannibal!
What?
Burn my farm too, please!
What?
Burn my farm too, please!
No! Remember...
Well, you got to admit, he's a genius. Hannibal's problem, however,
I guess he is.
Stay on the move to keep supplying his army from the local lands. At one point, he entered Campania, one of the richest regions of Italy, great for resupplying and great for showing up Fabius in front of Rome's South Italian allies. But he was caught in a valley, and Fabius quickly moved to block his. Used up all the valley's supplies, he'll starve. Sir, what are all those lights leaving the valley? Is he trying to escape? Lights in plain view. Well, that's a trap if I've ever seen one.
Great.
We're falling for
Fabius refused to budge, but other Romans in the valley rushed to confront Hannibal, only to find the Carthaginian army was actually just a herd of oxen with torches tied to their heads. They then found themselves caught in an ambush. With the Romans distracted, Hannibal's army was able to slip away into the night.
That was a pretty obvious trap.
Classic Hannibal. For all his action, the dissatisfied Romans mockingly dubbed him Fabius the Delayer. But the thing is, Fabius' strategy was probably the best thing he could have done. He was right that constant encounters with Hannibal were bleeding Rome dry, and the time he took allowed Rome some breathing room to recover their forces when they desperately needed to, while putting Hannibal into an increasingly more difficult position. Modern historians view Fabius' strategy as generally a good idea. To this day, the act of not engaging an enemy, but instead gradually wearing them down, is still referred to as the Fabian strategy.
What the Fabian strategy?
Came to an end. Fabian strategy. But when Fabius's term finally came to an end, the Senate couldn't have been happier. It was time to start fighting again. However, they probably had a little chat about how they were going to go about it. See, Hannibal's tactics up until now had been very sneaky. Or, if you're a Roman, you might say, I'm sick of it. Every time we try to take this guy down, we march straight at him. But then, oh no, Hannibal's hiding in a bush. Hannibal's got 30,000 men up a tree. At this point, I'm convinced my wife isn't just Hannibal wearing a disguise. This time, we obviously have to switch something up. Now granted, we're Roman, so we're gonna march straight at him without thinking. That can't be helped. It's in our blood. But I have a proposition. This time, when we march straight at him,
will you run?
I'm talking like 80,000 men. It won't matter what kind of shenanigans he pulls. He can hide in all the bushes he wants. There's no way he can possibly.
Who's gonna beat them?
80,000 men.
Who's gonna beat off 80,000 men?
You know what I mean. And so it was. With two new consuls, Rome put together a massive army, the biggest Rome had ever fielded, to put Hannibal away once and for all. Together, the men required, two-thirds of them ended up being completely inexperienced. But how much experience does it take to be expendable war fodder? As this massive army set out in the summer of 216 BC, the Romans knew they needed to win this battle. Just one victory over Hannibal would likely be enough to end his entire campaign. And this time, their overwhelming manpower gave them confidence they could do it.
They can't, absolutely.
At the town of Cannae, where he had captured an important Roman supply depot. With Fabius gone, Hannibal knew a battle was likely coming, and he was eager to fight it on his terms. But when his men looked out at the Roman camp, they couldn't.
Holy shit, that's big.
Seeing. That army's huge! There's no way we can possibly beat off all these men. How are we gonna beat off all of these men? You know what I mean? Hannibal. Hannibal is then said to have replied, Gisco, my friend, don't worry. There may be a lot of them, but amongst their ranks, there's not a single man named Gisco. This joke was apparently so funny that his officers began to laugh and laugh. And when his men in the camp heard the laughter, they were like, hey, they're laughing. I guess that means we're gonna win the battle.
That's actually a pretty small.
The consuls were another pair between an inexperienced hothead and a wise scholar. Although, the main historian from this era is good friends with Paulus's family, so take that with a grain of salt. On his day of command,
I guess so.
Hasty Varro, despite the apparent pleas from Paulus, sent the army out for battle. And when Hannibal saw this, he did the same. And here comes the single largest battle of the Second Punic War, and one of the most renowned battles in history, the infamous Battle of Cannae. In all the pre-battle maneuvering, this battle.
Wait, how do they know the exact date? Like, it says August 2nd. How the hell do they know the exact date? Okay, actually, the historian I was talking about really probably said it. But still.
In all the pre-battle maneuvering, Hannibal was able to ensure his army was fighting from the south. This meant the seasonal dust-carrying winds were to his back,
and blowing directly into the faces of the Romans. Like I said, control. After 2 years in Italy, Hannibal's infantry had dwindled to about 40,000. The Romans possibly outnumbered him 2-1. Their army was so big that their maniples stretched far deeper than they normally would. The Romans planned to charge Hannibal's thin, weak line like a battering ram and break it. They also chose a narrow battlefield.
It's actually pretty smart, too.
Hannibal's far superior cavalry from being able to outmaneuver them. They wanted an honorable battle where pure strength, rather than trickery, would decide the outcome. If Hannibal had his say, however, trickery might end up having a lot to do with it. He ordered his line to position themselves as an outward bulge, with his weakest troops at the very center. Just behind them, out of sight from the Romans, stood the elite Libyan infantry, waiting for their moment to strike. The battle commenced as the mass of Roman troops smashed into the Carthaginian center. The shape of Hannibal's line ensured the overwhelming weight of the Romans hit his weakest troops first, and they were pushed back. Hannibal's outward bulge reversed inward.
Whoa.
The Romans being funneled in towards the weak center.
Holy shit.
Had positioned himself at the center to encourage the troops to hold out as long as possible against the Roman onslaught. Because while the Romans were unleashing carnage on the center, Hannibal's cavalry needed time to do their job. The heavy cavalry on the left, after a barbaric fight, sent the Roman horse packing, with the consul Paulus even sustaining a severe head injury. He managed to move into the center to keep the battle going. The cavalry turned and approached Varro's cavalry from behind. At the first sight of the coming Carthaginian envelopment, Varro ordered his horsemen to flee the battlefield. The Carthaginians had won the cavalry battle. But back in the center, according to some accounts, Hannibal's line did eventually end up caving to the massive weight of the Romans, and they began to flee. The Romans pushed deeper, and organization within the army likely broke down as they became a giant mass trying to massacre the fleeing Carthaginians. They didn't realize that they were playing right into Hannibal's hands. At that moment, Hannibal's elite units, having done no fighting yet, and therefore fresh as a daisy, turned and smashed into the Roman sides. Many of these troops were wearing Roman helmets and armor they had picked up after previous battles, and the confused Romans may not have even realized they were the enemy. As Hannibal managed to regain the composure of his center and encourage them back into the fight, the Carthaginian cavalry swooped in from behind.
Ooh.
And look what lies before you.
A smile.
Military general's wet dream is a total encirclement of a much larger force by a much smaller force. The Romans were trapped. Hannibal had unbelievably managed to use
holy shit
numbers against them. Rather than simply encircling them, he had actually allowed them to use their own immense power and push themselves into an encircled position. This was the genius of Cannae.
Oh shit, that is real genius.
Began. For hours, the Carthaginians guarded the helpless Romans from all sides. The terrified Romans were so tightly packed that at times they couldn't even lift their arms to defend themselves. The killing went on so long that the Carthaginians became exhausted from the non-stop massacre. And by the time the butchery came to an end, the grim toll spoke for itself. To Hannibal's several thousand lost, the Romans suffered 60-80,000.
Holy shit.
Captured, yet another entire army wiped out by Hannibal. Many high-ranking Romans.
Holy fucking shit.
For one, but also 80 senators and more. It's been Paulus. Many high-ranking Romans met their end at Cannae. Paulus, for one, but also 80 senators.
Oh, what? Why were there senators in battle? Okay.
Of Rome's male population aged 18 to 50.
Holy shit. Well, at least it's not like Paraguay in that one war. Remember which one? I think against Brazil. They lost like 80% of their male population. So at least it's not as bad as that one. But that's still a lot of people.
Hannibal's vengeance. The stunned Carthaginians, as they searched for their own survivors among the dead, couldn't believe the sight of it. An estimated 30,000 gallons of blood now lay spilled on the battlefield. Rome's defeat at Cannae sent shockwaves throughout Italy. Just as Hannibal had hoped, most of southern Italy now defected to his side, including the second largest city on the peninsula. Wow. Hannibal, this is incredible. What could possibly come next? Next? Jim Bob. I've killed 100.
Oh, wow.
Romans. I've turned her allies against her. That's it. That's vengeance. So let me tell you what comes next. Rome surrenders.
Probably not.
Their territories are reduced. We recover our lost islands. And Carthage dominates the Mediterranean once again. But sir, what if they don't surrender? Jim Bob, did you miss what just happened? Of course they're gonna surrender.
They're not gonna surrender.
In his campaign, Hannibal had shown himself to be very adept at reading the Roman mind. But if he now thought that Rome might surrender, it was the first time he severely underestimated them. And he was about to discover an extremely inconvenient fact about Rome. Rome never surrenders. At a Roman survivor's camp near Cannae, one young officer overheard some troops discussing how they would flee Rome. Drawing his sword, he threatened to cut down any man that
would
in its hour of need. That officer was Scipio.
Yeah, Scipio.
But soon enough, the Romans would come to call him Scipio Africanus, the hero of Rome.
Oh, come on! Seriously, part three isn't... there's also part three, are you kidding me? Really, I made it. Sure it won't. It probably won't. It'll probably take like a month at least. I think. What, is it gonna be an hour long video or what? Alright, so that was the Second Punic War. Yeah, really good video, really interesting. So, guess I'll end the stream here. Man, Overson Foot is such a good YouTuber. Alright, bye.